so much for joining us today. This is our third webinar in the BASF Perimeter Pro program series, and we're so happy to have you join us all today. We're really excited to welcome Sylvia Kenmuir today, who will be speaking with us about stinging insects, scorpions, and spiders. She's got a lot of great information to share with us today, and I know you're all really going to enjoy everything that she's going to provide. So we have one extra exciting bonus that we'd like to share with you as a thank you for joining us on today's webinars. We will be doing a random drawing for three prizes. So we've got a backpack sprayer and two Yetis, and we'll be announcing the winner of that drawing at some point tomorrow afternoon. So again, just thank you for joining us, and hopefully you have some good luck and you win one of those great prizes. So we'll just go ahead and keep going. So for those of you who've joined us for one of our previous Perimeter Pro series webinars, you are familiar with the keys to the game that we've been sharing. So throughout this series, we've been providing some tips and tricks about how to build the best Perimeter Pro program that you can. And of course, the three main pillars of becoming a Perimeter Pro are start with building out an excellent IPM strategy. So of course, starting with an inspection, employing exclusion strategies, addressing those habitats where pests can hide and breed, and using a variety of control methods, including physical, mechanical, and chemical. The second piece of building out this great program is choosing the right starting rotation. So it's key to keep in mind how you pick those star players and making sure that you're selecting those based on pest pressure and seasonality. And then of course, rotating between star players based on modes of action is always a best practice. And of course, tailoring the plan to reflect the frequency of service that you've provided. And then last but not least, building a bullpen of trusted specialists. So making sure that you've got on hand those targeted products that will enable you to troubleshoot tough situations when and where they may arise. It's key to pick products that are reliable and easy to use, and of course, knowing when it's time to make a critical substitution. So these three pillars together form the foundational keys of the game in the Perimeter Pro series. BASF has a great lineup of options to help you make great decisions to build out your starting rotation and bullpen. So of course, our dilutables portfolio, including Termidor SC, Alpine WSG, Fendona, and coming soon, our new innovation Redesco, all make great choices for the starting rotation. And from the bullpen, we've got a huge lineup of products, you know, including a number of different PT brands, advanced baits, number of other products that you can use to round out that bullpen, depending on how you're doing your rotations, quarterly, bi-monthly, or whatever it is that you may be doing. And of course, you know, the importance of building out a great program following some of these tips is that it helps to reduce callbacks. And why is that important? Well, of course, the cost of callbacks is something, you know, that we all have to think about. So whether that's financial costs or kind of customer satisfaction costs or the time and disruption to your business that callbacks can lead to, making a few simple changes to your perimeter pest manage approach can have a dramatic effect and really help manage some of these considerations. We would like to invite you to kind of join the challenge. So throughout this series, as we continue to share great tips and tricks for how to become a Perimeter Pro, we've created an online assessment that you can use to assess your current practices, you know, start incorporating some of those keys to the game that you've been learning through our throughout our series, and then come back and take the assessment later to see how your scores improved. You will receive in an email that goes out tomorrow a link to a self-assessment that you can fill out. It's really easy to do. Just ask a couple questions to kind of help you think about, you know, where you are, think about some things that you might be able to incorporate, and really just a way to think about how to incorporate some of the things that our Perimeter Pro series has been offering. So with that intro, we're about ready to transition over to Sylvia. Throughout, as we go through the webinar, please use the Q&A box to enter your questions, and then we will have plenty of time for a Q&A section at the end of the webinar. So with that, I'm really excited to turn it over to Sylvia for our featured content.
Excellent. Thank you, Melissa. Appreciate the information. It's good stuff. Okay, let me just make sure I get everything turned on correctly here. I have to turn on my audio so you can hear. I got my sound shared. Okay, well, thanks again, Melissa. Appreciate it. So excited to be here today to talk about stinging insects, scorpions, and spiders. You know, the thing that we have to always remember is that, you know, as seasons change, different pests become bigger pests or become more fall invaders. And so this is perfect timing because as we start winding down a little bit with summer, it's still hot in a lot of places, but as we start moving into the fall, insects and spiders and scorpions do different things. And so it's really a time where we need to start focusing. Maybe we're looking away from ants and maybe some of the other occasional invaders, and we're actually looking at these guys because fall tends to be a big time right now when it comes to stinging insects. So we'll cover a little bit of that. As Melissa mentioned, we do have a variety of different options that we call, you know, our starters and our bullpen. And I don't know about you guys, but I've been getting ready for my fantasy football team. I do. I've been doing it for about 15 years now. And so computers and apps have made it way easier. So I'm thinking a little bit more about football and defense and offense. But, you know, as far as products go, some of our bullpen will actually move into our starters, especially when we're talking about stinging insects and wasps, and when we're looking at what tools to use. Something like PT wasp sprays and some of the PT brands like Fendona become really important because as we're encountering those pests, we're going to be moving into that. And then, you know, the other thing I want to cover is we also have some other great ideas when it comes to starters. But one of the things I've noticed, and I'm on social media like you guys, is, you know, a lot of discussion about Termidor SC and whether or not it's labeled for more than just termites and ants. And granted, this is like the go-to product for most people when it comes to ants and termites, but there's other pests on the label. And so we want to talk a little bit about spiders and wasps because, you know, Termidor does transfer. And so when it comes to social insects like wasps, this could be a huge advantage. So want to make sure that we talk a little bit about Termidor because it's definitely something that can be on your bench if you're looking for these particular pests. And so we're going to talk a little bit about an overview of these particular groups. We're going to talk about ID, more about behavior, because I always find that, as Dr. Bobby Corrigan says, we're observational biologists, right? And that's going to be for everything, not just rodents. It's going to be for insects and other pests. And so I definitely want to talk about that. And then we'll talk a little bit about your playbook strategies. All right, so let's get into the overview. You know, during a pandemic and everybody was stressed out and, you know, the perimeter areas became very important because we, you know, in a lot of places, we still are not so much welcome in people's homes. I think we're still dealing with a little bit of that. But, you know, one of the things that I don't know about you guys, but during the pandemic, my phone started ringing and my social media started ringing, you know, because of murder hornets, right? And so I hate that name. I really hope that from us, as far as industry goes, we call them Asian giant hornets. But, you know, this became news. It's still news. Washington is looking, has their first brew where they actually caught a part of a nest. And you can actually see it on video on the Washington Department of Agriculture's website of them actually hatching. It's pretty cool. But these haven't gone away. They're very localized. And so for my friends that are in my neck of the woods and in the West, especially for Washington and a little bit of Oregon, but not really as far as movement. We'll talk a little bit about what you need to know as a PMP because everybody is concerned about these. And I think we're going to see a lot more in the news in the fall because this is a particular important time for murder hornets because they're looking at bees as their targets. So we'll talk a little bit about Asian giant hornets. But when we look at this group in general, whether we're talking about spiders or scorpions or wasps or hornets or bees, you know, they are an important beneficial group. They serve as pollinators. Pollination is huge for us. We depend on that for a lot of the crops that we have. And so pollination becomes very important. They're predators, you know, they, especially for our folks in agriculture, they are constantly working on different pests when it comes to the sucking insects. They're laying their eggs inside their eggs. And so this is really important. And that's a parasitoid. And then for predators, you know, we're looking at spiders and scorpions. You know, they take care of a lot of the insects and other scorpions and spiders. And so this group is important when it comes to the benefits. The bad part is that they sting. Now, one thing I want to make sure we all make sure that, and if you're taking this back to your group to talk to them, make sure your technicians understand the difference between a bite and a sting. And I feel this is important because we want to make sure that when we're talking to our customers, we're talking about the damage that they're causing, correctly. And so a bite happens through biting action, right? And so, you know, this would be a beetle here, a grub, and you can see the mouth parts there. And so they bite. A sting is actually where venom is injected through a structure, whether it's a stinger like this, or whether it's urticating hairs, which we'll talk about in a few minutes. And so when we talk about somebody being stung by a bee or stung by a wasp or stung by an ant, we want to make sure we say the word sting, because a lot of times our customers don't recognize that and they think of it as a bite. And so just as professionals, we should know the difference between a bite and a sting. And if you ever are going to study for your associate certified entomologist or PHE, which is your public health entomology exams, these kinds of questions are important. Now let's talk a little bit more about stings. Now they happen quite often, and I found this as a very interesting statistic on the National Health website, but it says 80% of the people who die from a wasp or a bee sting are men. Now, that doesn't mean that you guys are a little more daring when it comes to playing around with these guys, but if we still look at the traditional roles of outdoor work, whether it is pest control, even though we have a lot more women in pest control, it's still primarily a lot of men. If you think about men that work on power lines or landscape industries, these are still very much predominantly male-oriented positions. And so because of those jobs, this statistic happens. But you know, there are people that die every year from bee stings or wasp stings or scorpion stings. And so this is a concern. Plus, it just doesn't feel good. It's definitely something that is concerning to people. And so when we're managing these pests, we have to ask ourselves a lot of questions when it comes to public safety and whether or not we're able to actually move those insects or those, you know, off target and move them somewhere else, or whether we have to eliminate them. And again, that challenge of the pollinator becomes really important. But they do sting. This is a bee sting up here where people can have a reaction. This is a scorpion sting here. And so, you know, definitely a concern for us. You know, one of my favorite people in the world is Dr. Justin Schmidt. And for anybody who's a big fan of the Marvel movies, I sat in the movie theater watching Ant-Man. And when they mentioned the Schmidt Pain Index, I was like, oh my God, I know what that is. And like, people are looking at me like, why is that girl getting excited? And obviously, because it was about ants, but also because of this index. And so Dr. Schmidt is, what they say about entomologists is, we don't have to be weird, but it helps. Dr. Schmidt actually created the pain index. And so he actually subjected himself to different stings and he rated it on pain. And so there's zero, which is the sting is incapable of penetrating the skin. If you look at something like a bee or a yellow jacket, you can see that there are two on the sting. And then number four, the sting of a bullet or a tarantula hawk. Now, I've actually been stung by a tarantula hawk on my back when I was collecting in college, and man, it hurt. And so that was a four. And so it's an interesting way to think about it, but pain is associated with stings. And he's written a fantastic book. If you ever are looking for something to read, it's on Amazon. It's called The Sting of the Wild. It's a very interesting story how he got there. But, you know, we all do kind of crazy things. And this is actually helpful when it comes to how painful are these stings, right? The other thing is that when we look at our industry and we look at the stinging insect group as far as management and protective equipment, we don't really have a suit that was created for eliminating and taking on a large colony. What we have is a bee suit that was intended for beekeepers. And this is one of my friends and also somebody who took my ACE class, Deanna Yorlin, and she actually modeled this for me. But she is a beekeeper. But those suits are intended to move around bees when they're docile in the process of beekeeping. It isn't a suit that was intended to go into a hostile, a ball-faced hornet situation or a yellow jacket situation and sustain aggressive behavior. And so we have to keep in mind that bee suits are sting resistant, not sting proof. Okay, you are going to get a fair amount of stings. We have some tips on how to make sure that you can avoid that, but you just have to keep that in mind. Other tools that we're going to need when we're doing this kind of work is going to be dusters. You're going to maybe use a dust. You're going to use aerosols. You may have an extension pole for your aerosols. You're going to be on a ladder. So you want to make sure you secure yourself and make sure you have a way to take care of yourself from fall protection. So lots of things that can happen. Be careful if you're using power equipment because they make a lot of noise and these guys don't like noise. And so you can disrupt them. But just keep in mind, suits are really intended for beekeeping. And with that, one of my friends, you meet a lot of people in the industry. And so I took Rodent Academy for the first time with Eric McCool. He does a ton of bee work. And so he shared these pictures with me of him doing some bee work, and he gets stung a lot. If you guys are ever following him, he gets stung a lot. And so I asked him, Eric, what are some tips for, you do a lot of bee work, what are some tips for fellow pest management professionals? And he said, one, make sure your suit fits properly. We have sizes from small to double X, triple X. And so, make sure that you sort of get measured and make sure they fit and adjust them as accordingly. Okay. Not all of us come in the same shape and size, right? No loose fabric around the legs, because again, as you're moving around, you can get caught on equipment. And then maintain your suit. And I found this to be very true. You want to regularly launder that suit to remove alarm pheromones. Have you ever gone on a job where, you put on your suit and the minute you get out there, they start attacking you? There may be some alarm pheromones from the last job you did. And so when they sense that smell, they actually might start attacking you and you've done nothing. And so washing that suit regularly will help, okay, keep that down. So that was something that I didn't really think about, but they do operate a lot on pheromones. So that would make sense. But in any case, remain calm. Don't wear scented cologne and perfume. So leave the axe behind that day. Do not wear bright clothing. I saw that some people are buying these in cute colors. And don't get me wrong, I would love a pink bee suit. However, they are attracted to bright colors. Insects see a different spectrum of color than we do. So we don't want to attract them to us. So the best colors are white or tan, something not too bright. You want to move quickly and quietly around them. And then again, if you're on a ladder, think about fall protection. So just something to think of. We always like to start with safety with our meetings. So I thought I'd do a little twist and talk about, insect safety. All right, so let's get into our different groups. The first group we're going to start with is the stinging insects. Now, what insects sting? When you saw this, you're probably thinking right away, bees and wasps, me too. But just, as a notation, there are some other insects that produce a sting. And so certain ants, right, we have fire ants, they would produce a sting. So that would be something that, they're very close cousins to bee and wasp. But then we also have some insects that have urticating hairs. And so urticating hairs is a great image here, but there's these little quills with venom on there, and they can actually be used for defense. Caterpillars and also domestic beetle larvae use it so that if something eats them and it's inside the throat, those hairs would cause irritation and they would literally spit it back up. So if you think of something like a bird. And so that's why they have those protective hairs to avoid predators from eating them. So this would produce actually some kind of sting, okay? This is not poisonous, where poisonous is you just touch the skin, nothing pricks the skin, and by mere touch, you think of some of those poison dart frogs, right? By touching them, they actually are there. So there is a difference between poisonous and venomous, okay? And so that's what produces a sting. But today we're going to focus on bees and wasps. Now the group is divided between the bees and wasps. It's how they live. And so we have the social or eusocial bees, which are the honeybees and the bumblebees. We have the solitary, meaning they don't live in a colony, bees, which would be like your mining bees, your sweat bees, your carpenter bees. And then when you get to the wasps, we have similar Segregation. So we have the social wasps, which live in a colony. And so these are going to be your paper wasps, your yellow jackets, your bald-faced hornets, and your Asian giant hornets. And then we also have quite a few solitary wasps. And, you know, to note when we're dealing with a perimeter situation, it might be cicada killers, maybe tarantula hawks, and then quite a few mud daubers. They are a beneficial group. However, anytime you mention a wasp to somebody, the word wasp or hornet, you know, it's a fear factor with our customers. And so it's sometimes hard to communicate that these guys are actually beneficial along with the solitary bees. And so this is the groups that we have. Now, one of the things I want to clarify, and I don't know about you, but I've asked myself this question in my journey of work is, well, what's the difference between a wasp and a hornet, right? We've heard them interchangeably used sometimes. And so here's the way it goes. All hornets are wasps, but not all wasps are hornets. All hornets are eusocial or social, and wasps can be either eusocial or solitary, as we just talked about. Really, the main difference is size and robust. And so if we look at something, and this is an image from that we'll discuss in a little bit from the Washington Department of Agriculture, you can see here, this is the Asian giant hornet. And so you can see how large they are in comparison to something like a cicada killer, which, you know, is usually given pretty good street cred when it comes to size. And so there's a big difference in size and robustness. And so if you look here, here's the European hornet, which is the largest hornet we have in the United States that we can actually say is pretty spread in throughout the country. There's lots of places that have European hornet. So it's the largest hornet we have. I know that Asian giant hornet is larger, but it's really localized. I'm really hoping to sort of minimize their impact on the whole US. And then you look at something like a yellow jacket. Look how wimpy and small a yellow jacket is compared to a hornet. So it's really about the you know, robustness and the size is the difference in why something gets called a hornet and something gets caused to wasp. So I just thought I'd clarify that because I always wondered, how about them? All right, so let's talk about eusocial bees and wasps. So not going to spend a lot of time on bees because we already probably know a lot about them. A few refreshers that are important when it comes to the behavior is that they do have a caste system because they are eusocial and live in a colony. So anytime we have a colony, we have different castes. Some have more, you know, castes than others when it comes to insects that live in a colony. But when it comes to bees, we have the queens, all right? And their stinger is curved with no barbs. So if you ever got a queen bee, she could actually sting you over and over again. And that's on purpose. When she starts out, a lot of times she's alone and she's got to defend herself, and having her stinger rip out of her body and kill her would kind of defeat the purpose of being the person that lays all the eggs, right? And so that's important. The drones are the males, and they develop from unfertilized eggs, and they have no stingers. They have no way to defend themselves, okay? And so that's the males. And then the workers are all sterile females. They have a straight barb stinger. And so these are the ones that can only sting once. The stinger comes out with the venom sac. And, you know, there's lots of ways to remove stingers. Make sure that you're trained on how to do that. Because if you pinch that venom sac and you don't do it correctly, you can actually shoot more venom in your arm. But that's a honeybee. Now, this is the European honeybee, Apis mellifera. Now, there is a subspecies, so to speak, Africanized honeybees. And this is, you know, a group that came over in the 50s from South America, and we still have areas that have Africanized honeybees. Although if we look in the Southwest, there is a lot of bees are considered hybridized because they're so close. They are able to mate, you know, they're not necessarily different species, but just a subspecies. So they are able to mate. And so like in the area that I live in Los Angeles and in the Southwest, we have a lot of hybridized colonies. And so we make the identification by behavior rather than by genetics anymore. I remember when I started in the 80s, we used to be able to actually collect bees that we thought were Africanized, and we would send it to the state entomologist and they would do DNA testing and they would tell you, yep, these are Africanized, or nope. We used to be able to say by size difference because Africanized honeybees were a lot bigger. Now it's really hard to tell the difference because of hybridization. So base it on aggression. If you've got a group and you're in an area where Africanized honeybees are a problem, especially like in the Southwest, Midwest, bottom of the country, you know, and they're aggressive, then you need to make sure that you are prepared for that, because they swarm more frequently. They are also very aggressive when it comes to alarm pheromones and the circumference that they defend, and they will pursue you a lot further than a honeybee, okay, a European honeybee. So just something to think about. We didn't get rid of these guys. They're still around. The other social bee that we want to talk about is the bumblebee. And so bumblebees are these furry bees, right? They have bands of yellow and black. The mature nest will hold about 50 individuals. They nest usually below ground, but sometimes they can be above ground in cavities, if you think of like tree hollows and that kind of area. But when there is a loud noise, when they are disturbed, they will also make a loud noise, and their stingers are very painful. It's a bee, but it has a smooth stinger, so they can repeatedly sting. So be really careful with these guys, because they're a lot bigger, more robust, and their venoms can be a lot more when it comes to their stings. And so they don't preserve their nests. Usually what happens is they collect these pollen bumbles, and then what happens is as we start going from fall to winter, we find that with a lot of our bees and wasps, they start, you know, they change from foraging from nectar to building colonies. Then in the fall and winter, they start looking for protein to feed the queens so that they're ready to overwinter. And then depending on where you are in the country, either if, you know, if it's snowing, well, then you're not going to see them around. But, you know, in the areas where it may not be as cold, you might have a few more individuals living. But this is sort of the cycle that we find with bees and wasps when it comes to seasonality. All right, let's switch gears to the different wasps and hornets, okay? And so very similar behavior in the colony, in that they have queens that are fertile females. Their workers are infertile females, okay? And they do most of the labor. And then the drones, again, are from, don't have stingers. They fertilize eggs. And again, they're born from unfertilized eggs, all right? And so this is what we're talking about when we talk about the wasps in general. So for wasps, there's a couple of resources that are very important for them for survival. First, it's going to be water and paper. They make their nests. And so if you think of all of the nests you might have seen in your career, whether it is a bald-faced hornet wasp or whether it is a nest that's created from a yellow jacket, you know, those are all done from a little bit of moisture in their mouth, spit, and some kind of paper, whether cellulose, okay? And I have a tree bark here, but that could be from a newspaper. It can be from plant materials. It can be from tree bark. And so they're very creative. It's important to think about that, because that takes a lot of work. When we have a wasp nest and we are removing them and we use a pesticide to do that, it's important to remove the nest when we can, because later on, if somebody comes by and there's a nest already for them and they don't have to do anything, they will reoccupy, because you just save them a ton of work. They don't have to go find water. They don't have to go find cellulose. They don't have to put it all together. It's a lot of labor. And so really important to think about that when we're trying to destroy the nest, because they will reoccupy nests. And in a lot of the products we use, you know, we're talking year over year, it may not have the residual that you want. And so just treating them isn't enough. And then as far as they go, they also have ways to protect themselves when it comes to survival. And so you think about it, first they have coloration, right? These are warning colors. Anytime we see colors like red or yellow, if we think about stop signs, right? They have red, yellow, and then green. So the same thing with you know, wasps, is that they are yellow or they're red in color, like, hey, look at me, I'm probably not good to eat. I probably can hurt you. The next thing that they do is they make a buzzing noise. Okay, that's again, hey, really, I wasn't kidding. Yellows really means I'm not a good guy. You really might want to stay away from me. And then if you don't heed those warnings and you're an animal or a person, well, then you get stung. Okay, and so that's really the necessities that wasps need for survival. Now, they, again, as I mentioned earlier in seasonality, spring is really when we start seeing them come out and they start feeding. They're looking for nectar. They're sort of building colony numbers that continues through the summer. And at some point at the end of summer or fall, they switch their food source to protein. And so this is when our barbecues become very attracted to them, because we're making meat or hot dogs. We find that You know, this is where if you're an Asian giant hornet, you're looking for insects. And so their dietary needs change. And that's why fall becomes such a bad time of year for wasps in the late, you know, late summer and fall. It's because their numbers have grown and because now they want protein. And so we become much more attracted to them because we've got stuff they want. And then once we get to winter, depending on where we are, most of the time these colonies are going to dry out, right, and die. But if we're in areas that have climates like are my friends in Arizona that have beautiful climate all year long, well, then you have persistent colonies that can actually survive year on year and get really, really large. Okay. And so seasonality becomes important when it comes to our control, because that's why fall tends to be such a bad time of year for wasps. Their numbers are high and they want our food. But let's talk a lot about some of these wasps, okay? So these are the paper wasps. There's about 22 different species out there. Sometimes you see them like this, where they almost resemble a yellow jacket. But the way that we would know this isn't a yellow jacket without having to look at anything else but antennae, okay? There's some differences in the body when it comes to robustness, but when we look at the antennae, paper wasps will not have a solid colored antennae. It will be usually black tipped off in yellow or black tipped off in orange, but that's the sheer easiest way to be able to tell the difference. When we get to yellow jackets, you'll go, oh yeah, I totally see it. They make these not enclosed nests. And so you usually can see the brood and you can see them exposed. When you see them, you know, with a cover on top, it means they're still in there cooking. When you see them open, it means that they've already emerged. Okay. And usually we can see these nests. And then here's another species where, again, the coloration can be a little bit different for paper wasps, 22 different species. Paper wasps are not a, you know, they're 3/4 to 1 inch long, so a good size wasp. They gather fibers. And, you know, I love this picture with this nest because it looks like obviously they were collecting either flower petals or something to make this beautiful colored nest. But, you know, so a lot of times it's just what, you know, regular old white or beige. Again, they use their saliva. They construct it. If you don't remove this nest, they will 100% come and re-inhabit it, really, because it's a lot of work. They also are sometimes called umbrella wasps. The nests have these open combs. And again, they have this little petiole. They're kind of on a stalk. And we call these guys more of a stinging insect that's non-aggressive, okay? They are more defensive stingers. So we have defensive stingers and aggressive stinging insects when it comes to the wasps and hornets. And so generally, they will only attack if they're threatened. So if they're in a spot where they've made their nest and it's constant movement and, you know, people or dogs or animals, then they may sting a little bit more because they feel threatened. But they're not aggressive stingers. That's going to be something like a yellow jacket. They're aggressive stingers. And so that becomes important in management, because if we're walking into a situation and we're dealing with a defensive stinging insect, we're not going to expect that we're going to have to, obviously safety is important, but we know that they're, as long as we can eliminate them quickly, we're not going to have too much of a problem when it comes to stings. They're generally fairly easy to manage. When we get to something like a yellow jacket, those guys are aggressive. They sting no matter what. They always wake up on the wrong side of the bed. So we have to be a little bit more careful, because it doesn't matter how quiet or what time of the day, they're always going to be not happy. Speaking of yellow jackets, here was what they look like. We used to have Dr. Rick Vetter and UC Riverside that did a lot of work with yellow jackets. But there are a few different species that we will find. Again, they are this yellow and black. They're not big insects, as you saw on that scale a little bit earlier. They're, you know, medium-sized wasps. They do have this all black antennae. Okay, so as I mentioned, a lot of times people will misidentify paper wasp species with yellow jackets. And the reason that's important is because we may be looking for an umbrella nest in a paper wasp situation, but in a yellow jacket situation, we're looking for an enclosed nest somewhere. It could be in the ground, could be somewhere on the structure. And so we're looking for different places, because ultimately, when we want to eliminate these pests, we got to find the nest, right? And so black antennae is what we're going to find. They follow that seasonality. They're nectar and, you know, pollen, and then late summer, fall hits and it's protein. It's protein, and that's their primary food source. And again, they are aggressive stingers. They sting with little provocation. So as a reminder, paper wasp, tipped antennae, blown, and then where you have the all black antennae, I'm going to be on all the different yellow jackets. Okay. Let's look what that looks like when it comes to making their cells. This is what it looks like if you're underground. You know, it's the umbrella still, right? You still see that umbrella nest, but it's actually enclosed and underneath the ground. And in fact, there's a lawsuit in California that's still going at a golf course where a golf course is being held liable for somebody who got stung with yellow jackets. And the golf course maintains that they didn't know that they were there and that it just happened. And, you know, they entomologists get in there, forensic entomologists, and they could actually show that there had been a large colony there for a really long time. And, you know, they don't just happen overnight. And so, you know, they were able to show that they have been there a long time and that they did know about it. So who knows where that's going to happen. I'm a golfer myself. And so I don't want to ever have to worry about hitting something in the fairway and getting next to a yellow jacket nest, right? But typically they're going to be underground. You know, during COVID, we had a lot of nests in a lot of strange places. You know, when you're not out there looking at your property or businesses have been closed, they've been able to do that. I think I recently saw one on social media with a hornet that was in a car, a vacant car where they build a nest. So they're very opportunistic if they're left alone. But typically in this ground, you know, if you're in an area where, you know, there's no development and all of a sudden you're going to put a beautiful community on top of here, you know, you could be disturbing very large colonies. And so it's not unusual for me to get calls from a territory like in Utah where they're building new areas. And they're like, God, we never had yellow jacket problems. Well, the area never had yellow jacket problems because you weren't building homes on there. Now that they're building homes, guess what? Hello, it's yellow jacket country. But they build these nests. Again, the combs are inside. If your seasonality is mild and you don't have severe winters where you have a lot of snow or a lot of moisture, you can have colonies that are perennial and they can just get bigger and bigger and bigger. Okay. And so that's something that can happen. The other wasp that's out there that's a eusocial wasp is the bald-faced hornet. Now this one has, again, remember all hornets are wasps, right? Well, it's actually an aerial yellow jacket, okay? It is a type of wasp. It's not a very robust one, okay? But it's always above the ground. They make these beautiful pear shape, and I've seen some great pictures on social media. You guys have been seeing them out there, and they make beautiful buzzing noise, but they can be aggressive stingers, and so they're similar to yellow jackets, and so they will sting with little provocation, okay? And so, again, it's always a challenge because I know we would like to relocate these guys, but if they're in somebody's, walkway or they're threatening people, sometimes we have to make the difficult decision to manage them. All right, so let's get to the Asian giant hornet, okay? And so this particular insect has also got the terrible common name of murder hornets. I really, again, would like to have you guys call them Asian giant hornets. Murder hornet makes it sound like, you know, I only use the word murder when I'm talking about people. I don't really talk about bees as being murdered. We don't talk about, we just murdered some ants today, right? So let's try and use Asian giant hornet. But the reason why it has this tag of murder is in that their impact on honeybees. Now, they come from Japan. You know, that's a lot of the area where you find them is Japan. And what happens in Japan is that seasonality, very similar to us, they're in the same kind of climate zone as us. If you took a map and looked, is that at certain times of the year when they're searching for their protein, honeybees are easy pickings. And then you think, well, why hasn't this been a world problem for Japan? Well, Japanese honeybees don't do a great job of making honey. They don't like use them like we do here. And we don't really even have our own native honeybee for that, right? We have the European honeybee, which, you know, they brought over on the Mayflower. And so, the challenge is that, you know, in their native country, they aren't really a problem other than another stinging insect, because they don't impact their agriculture like it's impacting ours. And so that's where I got the word. They're not aggressive, but they're actually defensive. And so they very similar to a paper wasp, they will only sting when they are threatened. Okay, that's really what they're gonna do. They're not out there like yellow jackets stinging anything. That's great because they're pretty big. Sometimes it helps to see, you know, kind of get out there and see different things. And I have a colleague in Japan that hooked me up with this person. This guy here does a lot of Asian giant hornet work. And, you know, here he's holding one. He's actually holding a male. So you can look really cool holding a male that doesn't have a stinger, right? But you can see how big they are. I mean, they really are good size. This is a nest that he has extracted from a car that wasn't being used. And they just sort of went around the wheel inside. And then he sort of laid the queen on his phone so you could see how big they are. So no kidding, this is a really large wasp. And so the Washington Department of the State Department of Agriculture has done a tremendous job. Washington has a lot of agriculture besides wine, besides the floral industry, and besides apples and, you know, any kind of insect that's going to impact their pollinators could be devastating to the Washington economy. Also, British Columbia depends on that. So they've done a really good job of not only in having the public, which they've called them backyard scientists, look for these colonies, because we just can't be everywhere and see everything. And so it's been a really interesting to watch them and the tools that they have available, all free. Go to their website, put in Asian giant hornet, and you will see a ton of tools. But one of them is, you know, trying to help people understand the seasonality. You can take most of the wasps we have and put them on the same cycle, right? We talked about the time where they're building colonies in the summer. And then, you know, we're here in September, right? And so now they're looking for protein. And so they're looking for bees. This is when they usually go in. And bees are easy to, they're little, they take them over, they eat their brood, they eat their workers, and they're just easy pickings. And so that's why they pick on bees, really easy to do. In October, November, they're gonna mate. And then, you know, what's gonna happen is they're gonna overwinter and we start all over. I think that in March and April, they had a campaign about talking about, hey, if you see any of these hornets out, you know, make sure that you alert agriculture. And so that's been something that's really important. So now that I've told you, it's really centralized, you know, really localized, it's only in Washington and British Columbia. So what do you need to know as a pest management professional? So here's what you need to know. First of all, the wasp has only been, or the hornet has only been found in Washington State and British Columbia. Practically zero chance that anyone outside the Northwest or BC are going to have any encounters with this wasp between 2021 and maybe even the beginning of 2022, unless somebody moves them somewhere else. That's how we get those introductions into places. If somebody lived in Washington and they decided they wanted to live in Texas and they brought belongings that had a nest, right? So translocation can be a problem. Most of your experience is going to be explaining to your customers that they do not have Asian giant hornet. Okay. And so really important for you guys to know which ones you have in your neck of the woods and make sure that you educate your customers, because it's almost disappointment. Like my neighbors come over and go, oh, look, I think we have Asian giant hornet. I'm like, nah, that's just a cicada killer. And they're like, oh, they're, you know, they're kind of sad. I don't think they should be, but that's just kind of how it is. So, you know, that's what's important. So sizing them up is important. This again is free on the Washington State Department of Agriculture, but they have a picture of them, and then all the different insects that are, you know, out there that could be, you know, mistaken. But once you see the size, you're not going to. But, you know, yellow jackets are very, very small compared to them. So that's really, you know, why ID is important. I know that it's always not fun sometimes, but it's important because your customers are home, they're asking you questions. And so knowing a little bit about Asian giant hornet will help you. All right, so that's our eusocial or social insects when it comes to stinging. Now we're gonna switch gears real quick to talk about solitary bees and wasps. Now these guys are normally not aggressive. They're considered beneficial. These are your parasitoids and your predators. They again, you know, they are looking for nectar if they're a bee. This is gonna be like your carpenter bees or your sweat bees, your digger bees, leaf cutters, masons. I mean, they do a number on leaves, especially if people have prized dahlias or big leafy flowers outside and they're doing these notches and they're like, I don't, you know, that's a nuisance, right? And so it's taking a moment to explain to your customers that, you know, anything you use is not going to remove them because they're just using the leaves to make their nests. So that's always a challenge. And then the wasp, again, the minute you use the word wasp, people freak out. They think they're going to get stung, but these are going to be the mud daubers, the cicada killers, you know, the spider wasps. These guys are really looking for something to lay their eggs on. And so these guys are do have stingers and they can sting if they're provoked, but normally they're considered non-aggressive and beneficial. The first one I want to talk about is carpenter bees. These guys are solitary. They can cause damage, right? Because first of all, people mistake them for honeybees. So, you know, these are what our male there, female up there. This is what a furry little bumblebee looks like. So sometimes people confuse them, but you can see they have more of a shiny abdomen there. So very similar in color, but not the same. Traditionally, they're a solitary bee. And somebody in a recent class asked me, are you sure? And I actually did some research and found out, okay, most of the time they're solitary, but sometimes mothers will share with their daughters their excavated nests because it's a lot of work to chew wood and make nice grooves. And so sometimes they will do that. But for the most part, we can say that they're solitary. And they are important pollinators, especially for open-faced flowers like the Gerbers and so forth. They will be very important for pollination. So we want to make sure that we don't consider them all nuisance. But once they get to somebody's home, then it becomes a problem, right? Because we have this. We have the entry hole, right? Because they're trying to make a hole. Then they're making all of their different cavities to lay their larvae in. And it's always going to be a long, right, horizontal. Okay, they leave frass, right? And then what will happen is if it's in wood that a woodpecker, then they'll make noise. And so sometimes people can say they hear the crunching noise. And then, you know, they can cause considerable damage. And so we'll talk a little bit about what you can do for those guys, because it is important. As I mentioned, making these kinds of, whether it's a nest or excavations, is a lot of work. And so if you don't plug it up and don't fix it, what'll happen is they'll just reinfest, okay? Some of the solitary wasps that are important is really the mud daubers. People see them out there all the time, or the thread-waisted wasp, because they've got this long petiole between the abdomen and the thorax. And so these guys make these organ chamber, or, you know, they're in the soil a lot because they're making these nests. These guys, again, will lay their larvae, and they take different insects and put them in there for food, okay, or spiders. And so they consider it to be a predator. But again, people get freaked out because they see them, and, you know, they're either brightly yellow, or the real pretty ichneumon ones are like a blue color. And so, you know, again, having that conversation with your customers that they're beneficial. All right, so changing gears, we're going to move to scorpions, okay? And so before you tune out, you think, oh my gosh, I don't care about scorpions. I don't live in Arizona. Hey, look, there are more scorpions in places that you didn't think. Look, there are over 90 identified in the U.S. And look, all of these great places have scorpions, okay? So you can only tune out if you're in the Dakotas. You know, Arizona, definitely the hot spot, but we do have some areas around Arizona that can be a problem, including Texas. And so there's scorpions in more places than you think. If you're taking your ACE exam, you would need to know this stuff too. And so here's where they're located. They're not insects. They are actually a type of, you know, they're in class Arachnida. And, you know, a little bit about their biology or the morphology is that they have really crappy vision. Think about having your eyes here and at the side of your head and trying to see all at the same time. And so their vision is really poor. Look at these eyes. And so they really depend on other things. And so similarly, they have a lot of hair. So sound familiar, maybe like a rodent, right? Poor vision, but they use vibrissae for hair. Same thing with the scorpions, poor vision, and they use ceti or cilia. And so on their legs, they have ceta and cilia. These are hairs that help them sense things. And so this can help with not only heat, but it can also help with vibrations. And then on their chelicera, they have larger, thicker hairs, like whiskers, that are called trichobothium, and that will also help them sense. So if you think about them, they're sitting like this on the ground, they can feel vibration and decide, is that food or should I run and hide because that's a predator for me? Okay. And so that's what they're using, but their vision is terrible. Okay. When we look at their body and we flip them on the other side here, you can see this is where their chelicera is. And so that's her chewing mouth parts. Okay, so they have to chew their food. They also have a sensory organ here called the pectens. We don't know a lot about scorpions. There was one guy that wrote a book and then he died tragically in a boating accident in Baja de Los Angeles. And that's like our only really good book on scorpions. And if you wanted to buy it now, it's like $500 on eBay. But you know, we know a little bit about this. We know that during mating, they're important because the male uses that as a rake to clean the surface off to put his sperm sac on. We know that, you know, sometimes when they're alerted, they move and they've got these little teeth on there. From a pest management standpoint, this is actually a really good structure for us because dust can get caught in there and enter the body. And so it's like this area that, you know, we don't know a lot about, but we know that we might be able to take advantage when it comes to management. Now, when we look at them as far as eating goes and how they feed, here's a scorpion where it's actually, see, they, you know, they actually take their mouths, move side to side. Remember that they don't do this, they do this, okay? And so you can kind of see that, you know, they're actually taking the, you know, the chelicera and putting the food in the mouth, and that's how they feed, okay? And so that's what we're looking at with feeding. Here's those pectins, as I mentioned, a closer look, you can see they're almost like finger-like projections. And this is actually dust, a scorpion that's walked through a dust surface and they picked up dust on their pectins. So that's something that's pretty cool. They have a very thick cuticle, and this makes them challenging to manage because we've got to get our products to not only get on this surface, but penetrate the surface. And so when we look at that cuticle, you know, it can take a lot to get down into the area that we need to get into the hemolymph of the insect and the nervous system to be able to get control. And so our challenge is that this is great, right? When you live in the desert, you need a way to protect from moisture loss. And so that's why they have it. For us, we have to find products and formulations that are a little bit more effective when you have an insect with the cuticle. And that's why the encapsulated products do so well, because it sits there for a while and then sort of gets absorbed into that cuticle. When it comes to behavior, we don't know a lot about them, but one of the things is that they have some weird behavior. And one of it is that they will do this claw walking. And you can see there that paper actually is treated with a pyrethroid. And you can see that the scorpion detects there's something going on. And so it doesn't really want to lay its body on the surface. So it does this sort of claw walking to avoid the surface. Well, that's not going to help us get in contact with them. And so, you know, that's one of the things that they do that makes control challenging for us, because they don't want to touch the surface. Now, okay, then so we have to make sure that we're also treating vertical surfaces, and that, again, we get penetration of that product into the soil. A majority of them are nocturnals. This is also a problem for us. We're not out doing night inspections. We're out there during the day. So they're hiding during the day and they're sleeping. They have the lowest metabolic rate among arthropods. Okay. And so they can go a whole year without moving. If I was going to be an arthropod, I might be a scorpion. Well, you can sleep all the time. And, you know, this helps them regulate their temperature. They live in hot places. They do fluoresce with light, and, you know, that's thought to be mating, but, you know, we don't know a lot about them. Their food sources, you know, again, an easy way for us to control scorpions is to control their food sources. Cockroaches are their favorite food. And so this is a Turkestan cockroach, huge, you know, every year I hear different places that are having issues with Turkestan. Started, you know, in the West, Southwest, and now it's kind of spreading around. And so they look very similar to an Oriental cockroach or an American cockroach, but, you know, different colorations here on the side, you get this little yellowing color, and so a little bit easier to see. But they, you know, will hold their prey and just eat them. Crickets, all of these things. So reducing that food source is going to help you with scorpions. And again, all scorpions are venomous, and they have a stinger. And even when people do stupid things like this, they're all venomous, okay? And so we just wanna make sure that we know the difference between poisonous and venomous, right? Poisonous is to touch, venomous means it gets injected. All right, the most common species we have throughout the US is gonna be striped tail. We have quite a few Vigovius species throughout the United States, which is the striped tail. But you know, if we're gonna get to the Southwest, they also have Arizona hairy, and then we have bark scorpions in a couple of different places. Now, the first two are considered beneficial, they're predators, but bark scorpions, you know, while they're predators, their sting is really bad and can be dangerous to people. But we have two centroides species in the US. We have Exilicata, which is going to be the Arizona bark scorpion. This is one that is very aggressive and can be, it's a crawling one, and they like up high areas. And then this one here, Vitatus, is found in New Mexico and Texas. This one, not as much a burrower, but you know, there are two different species. So make sure that when you do the ID, you know that if you're in New Mexico or Texas, you might, you know, we're seeing bark scorpion move all over the place. They are getting translocated through plant material and so forth. And so this one, Arizona, Nevada, and California, likes to be out high up, not social, so doesn't really like to hang out with other scorpions. This one here, Texas, New Mexico, likes being on the ground, is a little bit more social because, you know, burrows are usually close. All right. Last pest we're going to talk about is spiders.
Sometimes we do stories and say they, and we tell you don't try this at home.
And I don't think we have to tell you this, but really don't try this at home. A Fresno man nearly burned down his house overnight trying to kill spiders.
Yeah, the man was using a blowtorch. That blowtorch started a fire. The fire spread to the garage and then into the 4,000 square foot house. Firefighters did save the home, but the damage, as you can see, was pretty extensive.
All right. Every year we have one of these, right? Every year somebody does something crazy because of the fear of spiders. And you know, the truth is, the majority of them are beneficial. We certainly have a handful of species that have venom that can have a very adverse reaction to humans and to pets. But for the most part, they're predators and we consider them beneficial. And only in October do people love spiders, right? Because then they're putting their own fake webs and big giant spiders out there. But after that, nobody wants spiders anywhere near there. And this is always tough for us because they do play an important role in nature for managing different insects and even other spiders. But, you know, so spiders, again, they're in class Arachnida, so they're cousins of the scorpion. They're an order Araneae. All right. They are most likely they're going to live for approximately a year. Very few of them will live for more than a year, so they're not going to be around forever. But, you know, if you have tarantulas, those large body ones, they can live 20 years. That's why people have them as pets. Brown recluse spiders can actually live 3 to 5 years. And then females tend to live longer than males. That is not because of anything other than males tend to be food sources for females, okay? And so that's really why they live longer. Now, when we look at the morphology and making our IDs, make sure that we understand they have a different body segments, right? Insects have head, thorax, and abdomen. They have a cephalothorax, so fused head and thorax, and then an abdomen. They also have pedipalps, okay? This is going to help them eat. And then they also have the chelicera or the fangs, okay? So that's what we're looking for when we're looking for morphology, because sometimes when we're making our ID, they ask you to look at these different places. Usually I use eyes. Eye patterns are very distinct, and so they're very helpful for identification, especially if you think of brown recluse, very easy. But vision, really important for the ground scorpions, and for web builders, they don't need that great of vision, okay? And I will tell you, and as an entomologist, you can get fun stuff. Thomas Shahan, which is a guy that I took a photography class, he has this amazing t-shirt that has eye patterns all over it. If you want to not have a second date, you can wear this to sleep. And I promise you, the person that you had had your date with will probably not want to see you again, just from possible personal experience. But spider eyes are pretty cool. Look at all the different ones out there. All right. So they have a couple of things about their behavior is that they feel vibrations. They don't really have, listening. It's going to be through vibrations. In fact, when I was taking spider biology at Cal Poly Pomona back in the day, we took out a field trip with a guy that had a tuning fork that could take a tuning fork and hit it at a vibration and put it on a web, and the spider would come out of its retreat and come out. It was pretty darn cool. They are predators, okay? They have spinnerets, okay? If they're going to be a web builder, and the spinnerets are, you know, located on the underside, web is made of protein, and each gland is connected to that to make those webbings. Now, when we look at spiders from a grouping from behavior, we have the web builders, and really the ones that are important for us are the cellar spiders and the comb-footed spiders. You know, we've got some other ones in here. Orb weavers become important in the fall because they make these huge nests, you know, webs right outside someone's door, and there's this giant spider sitting in the middle, especially like Araneae cruciferus, big giant orb weaver, and people are like, holy cow, that's crazy. They're terrified, right? They call you out right away. And so those guys, and then we have the hunters, which are going to be the ones on the ground. This is going to be your wolf spiders, your little jumping spiders, and maybe tarantulas in certain areas. Okay. So web builders, hunters. When it comes to the web builders, these guys here, you know, Folsids, man, there's a lot of bad information on Folsids. I've heard like they have the most toxic venom, and if they could only break the skin, you know, those are all wives' tales. Those are not true. But they are prolific. They are an invasive species. They've got these slender long legs, so they are not a daddy long legs. That's actually a common name for another arthropod, but they are long-legged spiders. Just call them fulsids. That's an easy way to call them. They don't bite people because they do have very small mandibles. They build these large irregular webs, and when the web's not sticky anymore, they just make a web somewhere else. And so they make lots of layers of webbing because they're just old, and because of the places they're at, they just don't get cleaned very often. Another web, another spider that's out there that has web is going to be the brown recluse, okay? And so they are also known as the fiddleback or the fiddleback, back spider or the violin spider or the brown spider. They've got that marking on the cephalothorax, so it's not going to be on the abdomen. It's actually on the cephalothorax, and their eye pattern, very distinct. It's three sets of two, so six eyes, two, two, and two. That's usually what I see first. Sometimes this is very pronounced and sometimes it's not. There's also six different species of Loxosceles in the United States. Here in my neck of the woods, I have Deserta, which is a desert species, and I have Arizonica, which is in Arizona. So you have different species within, but Reclusa definitely has been associated with necrotic wounds with the bites. And so this can be a problem. We also have the brown widow and the black widow. The black widow, again, web builder, shiny black. If they're immature, they're going to be a little different coloring, right? But we've got the hourglass on the bottom, right, on the dorsal side of the the ventral side of the abdomen. And then they've got this little shape there. They bite. Bites are actually painful. They cause an inflammation. And then if somebody is having a reaction, not everybody has this reaction, but it's a neurotoxin. So they can actually have problems with anaphylaxis with this particular spider. The brown widow is a relative. We see this in pockets in different places throughout the country. They're a little bit more prolific. If you notice with the black widow, they have these very round egg sacs where the brown widow has these like little asteroid looking things. But their color, our markings are a little bit different. They're definitely brown. They've got an orange little hourglass, and then they've got these, kind of different colored legs, right? And so that's what you're looking for. This guy here is probably responsible for more bites than any. This is the sac spider, the yellow sac spider. They're like a greenish yellow. And one of my favorite people in the world is Nancy Toronto with Rentokil. She says that this spider will just bite for sport. These guys are typically around bed frames. They make these sort of tubes that they use where they have their retreat when it comes to webbing. And so these guys tend to be a huge problem when it comes to biting because they do bite. And people have different reactions to venom. Okay. And so be very careful what you say about that. There is a section on the CDC website that talks about venom. Let them do it. All right. So that's all of our biology and behavior. Let's talk about our strategy. Again, IPM strategy is always going to be important, especially with these guys. Exclusion is huge. Sanitation is huge. Because if we can do that, our products don't have to work hard, or we might even have to put products out. Maybe it's just defense, for other insects that will sort of overlap. But really important that we focus on inspection and prevention. We use a bunch of techniques, including exclusionary tools like the web removers. And then, chemicals will definitely help pick up. And so for here and for our team at BASF, we like to think of these rings of protection, okay? Really looking at what am I doing inside the house? What am I doing around the house? What am I doing in the yard? And then all the way at the end, right? Because if you think about that, you sort of, as a defense, right, we're trying to see how we can limit the insects from actually getting into the structure. So when it comes to inspection, depending on the pest, you're going to be looking all over. If you're talking about a stinging insect, well, you might be up here looking for high areas where they're building nests. If you're talking about scorpions, it might be down here. If it's a bark scorpion, they could be climbing. But, we should all be looking at all of these different areas and having some kind of checklist when it comes to looking at our inspection sites. Look for tools, man. We've got a lot of technology that can help you. And I'm probably old school with the selfie stick, but I really like using it to be able to get underneath areas and take pictures. I like to share pictures with my customers because, a lot of times you can tell them, you need to do this, but if you show them a picture, then it helps. And so I use my camera quite a bit, especially under the J trim here. And, this is what I'm looking for. This person here complained about scorpions entering. The garage seal is actually pretty good. But you know, we were finding them in this pocket here. So now it's like, all right, what's here? And so I could take the my camera, flip it around. I could take a picture. You can see me, say hi. And then, you know, here's where there's a lot of openings, and we sprayed a little bit of PT565 in there, and you know, out came a few things. And so these things are going to have to be corrected. And unfortunately in the Southwest, we have a tremendous amount of stucco, and stucco is just not perfect. It has to breathe. So we have weeping spots for it. When it comes to spiders, you know, they get in two ways. They are either brought in, right? Because we had some stuff in the garage and we moved it in like Christmas decorations and we brought in stuff. Or they're attracted to prey living inside. Maybe there's cockroaches inside. Maybe there's crickets getting inside. And so we've got to figure out how to exclude them and prevent them from getting in. Always look at our doors for everybody. You know, there's great products out there that you can use for door exclusion. Excluder is one of them. You know, weatherproofing is for weather. It's not necessarily for rodents or other insects, okay? A tight seal will help, but it doesn't last forever. So really look at those and see if there can be some improvement. And of course, if you got a customer that leaves the door open, well, then that's gonna be really tough, okay? And so that's prevention, that's training, right? But we're gonna be looking at treating these areas if we are using pest management products. Again, these common entrance points where they're gonna be getting in, that's gonna be helpful. Sanitation becomes really important. When we see things like this is a picture I took in Nevada on a scorpion and bark scorpion. And, you know, the pool is here. You can see the towels. And then we had these overgrown plants and there were bark scorpions there. There was a block wall. They're in there. So, you know, talking to your customers about eliminating this and cleaning it up. If they're wondering why their kids are getting stung with the pool right here, where you have a harbor site here. Underneath the house, getting underneath and looking if you have some crawl space there. And then if they have these kinds of things like rocks and so forth, making sure that they're done correctly. Sometimes they don't put the liner, it's too thick, and that's not going to help. Critical tools, especially for spiders, you know, a web remover. These are very important. I pull this out every fall and work on my spider webs until I get to October like 25th, and then I like them for decoration. And then glue boards. Glue boards are so underused. Please make sure you use your glue boards. They tell you so much about what might be entering the house and from where. Okay, and we read glue boards, right? Here you can see it's just a hot mess, but sometimes you only see it like on one side and that tells you how they're getting in. When it comes to sanitation, especially for your stinging insects, you know, people don't want stinging insects or they're highly allergic. Don't plant a ton of flowers. Like clover is a big problem if they have stinging insects. And then, you know, they have to wash their trash cans out once in a while, especially the recycling with soda cans and so forth, highly attracted to that. With bees, you know, we see these swarms, you know, sometimes they are, you know, they're migratory, right? They're going to move, but if they don't move and this person needs to get their car and go to work, you know, sometimes we can call a beekeeper, but sometimes it won't come out if there's hybridized bees. And so sometimes we have to eliminate them. And if you get inside a structure, well, that's a whole nother ball of wax. The most important behavioral trait about your stinging insect or bee or wasp is going to be whether they're eusocial or solitary. Dealing with one guy that's not aggressive, that's they're not going to, you know, attack me right away. Or am I dealing with a yellow jacket, which is very aggressive, and they're going to come in numbers, right? Because then they're going to know which tool to pull out. And so that's where identification becomes really important, knowing the right modes of action. Is my product a knockdown product, or is it one that can transfer? And so remember, either they're defensive or they're aggressive. That's going to help you with your equipment, not only from a safety standpoint, but also in the tools that you select. And so when we look at our starting lineup, we've got Termidor and Fendona and Alpine. These are products that, you know, we use for other insects in our starting lineup, but they can be very helpful when it comes to stinging insects. And for scorpions and spiders, Fendona is phenomenal. Alpine dust, you know, dusting for scorpions is great. But here you might take some of your bullpen and move it on over like PT Wasp Freeze, okay, PT Fendona, because they can be very effective for some of these insects. So this is where there's some flexibility in pulling some of those products up. You know, we have various modes of action with products. We have a lot of pyrethroids out there, but we also have products that work in different groups like, you know, dinotefuran, which is a neonicotinoid. Fipronil, which is, you know, a phenol pyrazole wipe. I always think about that. Probably said that wrong. You know, you want to make sure that you pull all of your products and blend your mode of action. That's going to help with resistance, right? So various modes and different formulations and how these products come out, that's going to be a difference. Make sure that we always protect bees. You know, there's a fine line between the bee advisory box where we don't want to kill foraging bees, and that'll be on our Alpine product. But, you know, there are times that bees need to be controlled. And I like this statement from MPMA, regardless of whether a PMP are using neonicotinoids or pesticide products, they should avoid unnecessarily exposing bees to pesticide unless bees are the intended target for structural or public health. Okay, and so sometimes we have to manage bees, okay? But when we're out there doing ant control, we don't need to be hitting foraging bees, okay? The most important thing to know about your product and your mode of action when it comes to stinging insects, is it a knockdown active? There are some products like wasp freeze that are gonna knock them down right away, but there are some actives that don't. So this is wasp freeze here. It's been a staple of the industry forever and great product. It's got wasp and hornet. So my friends out here in the Northwest asked, do we have anything labeled for Asian giant hornet? And we do, right? But it is a knockdown. If you've never used wasp freeze, practice, because it comes out, can travel 15 feet, all right? And you can expand a can very fast. So make sure you've practiced with it. And then tips for using it, move slowly when approaching nests, wear protective equipment, use extension poles if they're way up high. And then, you know, again, protective equipment is going to be very careful. All right, be very, very careful. And then Terminator. So I've seen a lot of chatter on social media. Can you use Terminator for stinging insects? Well, you can, all right? It's not just for ants or termites. You can actually use it for stinging insects, okay? And so it can be applied as a spot or crack and crevice treatment around windows, doors, and under the eaves for listed pests. And if you look, you will see that there's yellow jackets and paper wasps. And notice it says it's not a knockdown agent. So if you're going in there to a situation that's very aggressive, you're gonna need a knockdown agent. But let's say that you have treated that area with a knockdown and you're worried that they're gonna go in and out of that area. Well, you could apply a little bit of Terminator around those windows or around those, well, maybe it's a wind, you know, an area where there's a light. And what's gonna happen is, like ants, that product is gonna transfer. And so the beauty of a transfer product like Alpine or Terminator is that, like the dust, is that you are going to get a little bit of transfer. And so you're not going to get a knockdown, but you will get some transfer. So just a little tip. I treat my house with Terminator for that, with my spiders and my wasps. Bendona is also a phenomenal product for wasps. Here we did a little bit of a trial comparing PT Fendona, which is alpha cypermethrin, so it is a pyrethroid. But you can see that compared to some other products out there, you want something that works quickly, right? Because, you know, we're not killing wasps in a container, we're killing wasps that are all over the place. And so you can see that when you use PT Fendona pressurized, which pressurized products tend to be a little bit more different than the mixed products because of the propellants and the other stuff we have to put in there. And it's also not capped in PT Fendona, but like Fendona SCS. But here you can see that we've got some dead wasps pretty quick, all right? Same amount of product applied. So, you know, we want speed might be really important when we're doing a knockdown. Dusting, if you're doing the solitary bees, make sure that, you know, we go up and around. Remember, they're all along the, you know, they're not straight up, but they're along there. But, you know, Alpine dust will transfer. And so great product for not only scorpions, but you can also use it for stinging insects. As I mentioned, Fendona CS is definitely a great product for spiders and scorpions, alpha cypermethrin. Remember, we're trying to get through that thick cuticle. So really important to make sure that we use the label, you know, highest rates, make sure that you use enough water to cover the area that you need to, whether you're doing a 6-foot band, 10-foot band, and make sure that we really get our product into where the scorpions are, or when it comes to spiders, making sure you get enough coverage. The best tip for Fendona is going to be agitation. Agitation for all encapsulated products is really important. The only product, you know, formulation that doesn't need a whole lot of, you know, agitation is going to be like your solution products like Alpine. When it comes to SCs and also CSs, they need to be agitated. And more than just mixing it and more than just walking around with a backpack sprayer, actually shake it up. All right, really important. Again, dusting, very helpful in some of those voids that we can't get into. And, you know, scorpion control is tough. It's a tough pest to manage, but, you know, again, reducing their food source and using these products that are longer residual is going to help you. You know, our pro tip for spiders is going to be, you know, spiders don't like wet surfaces. They avoid them. And so once it's dry, however, they will walk across them. And so treat those areas that they're inhabiting. You may not get them right away, but as it's dry, they'll pick it up and then they'll die. Okay. And they've got these beautiful combs to do it. But always think rings of protection. That's important. Again, we're trying to protect different areas. And as always with stewardship, it's everybody's responsibility. So always follow the label, always refer to registered uses. Do not use it in a way that is not labeled. And with that, I am done.
Thank you so much, Sylvia. That was amazing. We just had such great information shared. Can't tell you how much we appreciate that. So at this point, everyone, we'd love to just open it up for a Q&A. So you can go ahead and type your questions into the Q&A box and we will get them answered for you. So maybe Sylvia, we've got one in there. Will Fendona deter yellow jackets from building underground nests?
Great question. So we know that there is a little bit of repellency when it comes to pyrethroids in general. But when we cap pyrethroids, we actually take a little bit of that repellent property. And repellent isn't necessarily a bad thing, but it, you know, but if we are doing something for ants or termites, obviously it's going to be a problem. When it comes to stinging insects, when you've actually capped that product, we actually find that we might, you know, they're not as repellent. And so the reason I'm mentioning that is because if you're thinking that you're going to keep them away from an area from building a nest, it won't. When they come in contact with the active, then they'll die. But if you're dealing with an underground nest, you know, this is where you got to charge the money. You actually need to dig a hole and remove the nest. Like you're going to have to, and estimate it that way. We're like, look, this nest is 5 feet by whatever, and add that into your job. Replace the soil with new soil. That's always going to be helpful. And I know that sounds like a ton of work. Just charge for it, because that's really how you're going to keep yellow jackets away from an area that they might have already built a nest.
All right, great. Thank you so much. So we've got another one. Do you think the Asian giant hornet will show up in other states?
So that's a great question. So I actually called the Washington Department of Ag last Friday and had a little bit of conversation with them on it. And so at this point, they are really doing a good job of trying to keep it there. And educating the you know, the people that this is, hey, before you move, if you're going to move somewhere, inspect your property because you don't want to take this with you. But right now it's been very localized. We don't know if it's going to spread to other places because they are really trying to limit their spread, but we just don't know. It's gonna if it happens and you're like in Pennsylvania, it's because somebody moved from Washington to Pennsylvania and they didn't notice they were taking something that had an active nest. I mean, there's gotta be a lot of stars that align. So at this point, we do not expect it. Where I would be concerned is the states that are neighboring Washington, like Oregon and California and Idaho, which also has a tremendous amount of agriculture. These states are very concerned and also have stepped it up. So, you know, I think that we're probably okay for now. We just don't know.
Yeah, that's really interesting. I mean, I thought those pictures you showed of the size of that was just incredible.
They are huge. They are huge. And I asked Justin Schmidt on a pain index, where would they be? He goes, and this is what he said, literally, unfortunately, I haven't been stung by an Asian giant hornet. However, my colleagues have. And if one stung you, it would be the yellow jacket, so a two. But he said if you were attacked by a colony, it could be the elusive five. So who knows?
Wow. All right. Well, let's keep the questions coming. We don't see a whole lot in there right now.
I do see one that says, you know, somebody that might have used Termidor or Psychic, but they didn't deter them. So remember, we're not trying to deter insects and we're not trying to repel these insects. we're actually trying to kill them and manage them. So sometime, remember, especially with a knockdown and Terminator, if you think about it, when you spray it for ants, you'll still see ants foraging, and you have to make sure that you've communicated to your customer, hey, you're going to see foragers still out there, because what's going to happen is they're going to pick up the material, they're going to transfer it to other ant members in the colony, and then they're going to die. And so, sometimes we have to look for that, and we have to remember that we are actually hoping that they take that material, transfer it to other members of the colony, whether it's a stinging insect or a spider when they're grooming, or, you know, then they'll be able to, you know, ingest the material. So, maybe that with the success, it was what you were trying to accomplish. So maybe try it again and look a little different for transfer rather than deterrence. That would be my best suggestion for that one.
Great suggestions. Okay. I don't see any more right now. So, the Q&A is open, so please go ahead and enter your questions. Sylvia's got lots more information. Oh, here. Okay, here's one. How quickly will a scorpion die after dusting?
That's a great question. So typically what we find with using dust, and I have to probably go back to Dr. Bob's trial. So I might want you to type your information there to be specific, because I don't know. But typically what we find with dinotefuran is it's a pretty fast mode of action. So if it gets on the pectins and it actually gets into the system, and right, so now we're waiting for grooming and we're waiting for the, you know, it actually to get into the, you know, the nervous system of the insect. You're probably looking at 48 to 72 hours to probably see that, but they, you know, because there's got to be, not only did they touch the surface, but they've got to ingest that. So if they're cleaning their pectin and you saw that measure where they're taking their chelicera and actually put it in your mouth, you're probably going to see it a lot faster. But if we're waiting for it to penetrate into the actual exoskeleton, it could be a little bit longer. But it is a different mode of action than you're probably using, because I find that for scorpion work, we use a tremendous amount of pyrethroid formulation and encapsulated products. And so you're definitely using a different mode of action. But if you type your information or reach out to me at sylvia.kenmuir@basf.com, I will go back and look at that trial that Dr. Bob did with Dr. Alvaro Romero in New Mexico, and I can see if it has the actual times.
All right, great. Specifically for spiders, how does Terminator work to control them?
So what Terminator does is it gets into the, as you saw, the foot of the spider. What happens is it actually gets into the foot of the spider and it moves into the nervous system and it kills the spider that way. And so when I use Terminator around my home, I'm looking for those areas around lights, because, you know, there's a lot of, when you have an outside light, it's a great place for a spider, right? Because they put up their web, because night insects are going to fly in and they're going to get attracted to that web. And so the spiders are hanging out there. That's the webbing is not what I'm looking for. So remember, web builders will have a web, but then they have something called a retreat, an area that they like to hide in afterwards. And so if you can do a really good job of treating those areas, as those spiders cross those surfaces and they groom, and spiders do a lot of grooming, they'll actually take that tarsi and they'll put it in their mouth and they'll ingest the Terminator, and then you'll get killed that way.
And could you comment on how it's different from a product like Fendona, specifically for spiders' outside structures?
Okay. So Terminator would be applied in very specific areas, because the label is very limiting, right? We have to only put it in those crack and crevices and those points of entry. Something like Fendona, you have a little bit more flexibility of treating larger surface areas. So you'll be able to actually treat sides of walls, or you might be doing more of a spot treatment in different areas because you can put more coverage. You can put it on, in certain states, you can put it on plant material. I think of sheet web spiders, where you're actually covering maybe plant material because you've got them making those webbings on the plants. So it's really more about where you can apply those two products as opposed to mode of action, okay? Because most of the insecticides we have all work on the nervous system of the arthropod that we're dealing with. Where it really changes is the labeling of that active ingredient. And so except for, I think, California, you can use Spendona CS in landscape settings. When you get to Terminor, you know, it's very strict.
Great insights. Thank you so much. So we've got another one here. How long will alpine dust be active in a wall void?
You know, that's another great question. As long as the product is dry and it's still there, because remember, insects are picking it up, you know, you could have up to 2 years with that product. What things that affect our dust is, first of all, translocation, moving, right? So you want to make sure that whatever wall void we're putting doesn't have any air movement in there. Moisture. And so if we're in areas like Washington and, you know, some of the places that rain a lot, if it's, you know, really humid and there's moisture, that's going to destroy our dust. But if we have those two factors eliminated and we don't have something picking up all of our dust, it can actually stay active for quite a long time. If you think of the shelf life, it's like at least 2 years on dust. So you're going to get a quite a bit bang for your buck. I like alpine dust. Not only is it really effective on, you know, for these insects that are in the wall voids like ants, or if you're dealing with scorpions, but also think about bed bugs. I did a trial with Gail Getty out here in California, and we used alpine dust in the wall voids because they get back there. And so you're using another mode of action to control an insect. So it's good stuff. You also have diatomaceous earth in there. And so you have another mode of action of the abrasion of the skin, allowing the pesticide to enter the cuticle.
Great. Well, it looks like one more question. What is the shelf life on Spendona CS? That'll be our last question. We're just about at time.
Okay. So capsulated products in general, what happens to them is, especially if they are stored in hot temperatures, you will find that those products will start separating. CSs tend to separate out of solution. It's not like alpine where once you mix it, it stays in solution. And so as it's sitting in the bottle, what we find is you'll see separation. So we want you to invert the bottle. And so basically what I mean by that, and let me grab a bottle so I can demonstrate it, is I don't need you to shake it like this. I need you to do this. So invert the bottle and put it back into solution, okay? And so, you know, if we find that, you know, you can have it probably for a couple of years, but if you ever run into a problem where the separation and it kind of gets a little bit like, I don't want to say batter, but, you know, it's the consistency isn't correct, you know, just reach out to your BASF sales rep and say, hey, I've been storing this product, I'm having issues, and we will get on it and get you either replacement product or figure out how we can avoid that. But, you know, typically what happens to the CSs is when they sit for a long time, they start separating. And so you got to use a lot of agitation to get them back into solution. So my suggestion with CSs is buy what you need, mix what you use. And, you know, also a 30-gallon drum, like we have these big giant drums, they've got these pumps on there that actually have recirculation in there to keep the product moving, keep it agitated, because if you let that drum sit, it's going to start separating. So, you know, one of the duties for your newbies might be, hey, go to the shelf and see all of our Spendona. Just take a minute and invert it. So it's a little bit of an exercise.
Great information. Well, thank you so much, Sylvia. And thank you so much to everybody who joined our Perimeter Pro webinar today. We really appreciate it. We hope you enjoyed all of the information, and we look forward to seeing you at our next event. Hope everybody has a great afternoon.